All over the country, the race is on to bring in our food. It's harvest time!
Gathering in the bounty of the land is the most crucial event in the countryside calendar. And now, as this year's harvest reaches its climax, it's time to see exactly what's happening with all our crops. Seeds of life to sustain us, fresh vegetables pulled from the earth, fruit that's our sweet treat, all conjured up from Mother Nature.
We'll be discovering the remarkable craft and magic of farming and finding out just where our food comes from.
No matter how clever farming becomes, our crops are still at the mercy of the weather. Harvest 2012 was a disaster. After record summer rainfall, crops failed and prices spiralled.
Can 2013 put our farmers back on track to deliver the food we all rely on?
As the harvest comes in, we will reveal the results. This time, we'll be uncovering the treasure of our land, vegetable goodness.
Which of our veg have been the winners and which the losers?
As the crops come in, we'll reveal the results.
Welcome to Harvest 2013.
It's great to be in Lincolnshire.
The vegetable-growing capital of Britain.
At the busiest time of year, harvest.
All around us, vegetables of every size, shape and colour are being gathered in from the rich earth.
I'm Gregg Wallace and I've been working in the veg business for over 20 years and I still get a real buzz at harvest time.
And I'm Philippa Forrester and as a very keen amateur grower, I'll be exploring the farmer's secrets behind those fantastic crops.
Over half the vegetables we eat are grown here in the UK and I'm going to find out the story behind this incredible edible business worth over £1 billion a year.
And now we're here at a most critical time. We're in the thick of the potato harvest and we'll reveal just how well all our vegetable crops have done in 2013. And we've got some surprises in store, even about the most ordinary of vegetables, the carrots.
And onions. They could well be struggling this year. And let's not forget our greens like broccoli. We'll find out why they've had a roller coaster year in 2013.
And food fanatic Stefan Gates will be here with some insights into nature that farmers must master if they are to produce crops like these.
We'll get a taste of the weird and wonderful new crops heading for our plates.
And find out about the latest sci-fi techniques for growing them.
But first, our big story and my absolute favourite veg ever, the not-so-humble potato. Do you know, we eat a staggering 24 billion of them every year.
Here, on this farm, we've followed the story of their spuds. Now we'll discover just what it takes to harvest them. From planting in spring, to flowering in summer, to now, the moment of truth, the first day of harvest.
Well, it's time to meet the farmer at the centre of this empire of homegrown goodness.
Son of this fertile soil, Andrew Burgess.
Andrew and his two brothers are carrying on a tradition that goes back four generations.
We absolutely love farming and growing stuff. It is an absolute passion in the family. In 1898, my great-grandfather bought a field of potatoes, which he then sold in London, and that's how the family business started. Since then, my grandfather and then my father and now me and my brothers have continued to farm and grow a whole range of vegetables.
Andrew's heritage is built on the potato, but the family business has mushroomed into a vegetable empire.
We're now growing a whole complete range of UK field veg, from broccoli, cabbage, cauliflower, Brussels sprouts, potatoes, onions, leeks, garlic, parsnips, carrots. So, yeah, just about everything you can possibly think of in the UK.
To get the crops in, Andrew works with growers across lots of different farms.
Our growing areas start in Suffolk. We work through the season and we always finish up in Scotland for the late season crops. So we're growing pretty much all over the east side of England.
Andrew also brings new kinds of vegetables to the UK, and that takes him further afield, like Spain.
My brother's taking the mickey out of me because they think it's a holiday, but it's not really. Because I love to go on these voyages of discovery. And what I'm looking for is anything new I can learn, bring home to the UK to make things better at home. How many other jobs do you get where you can sit out in an office like this? I love being a farmer. You know, it has its bad days, but 99% of the time it's brilliant fun, just working outside, working with nature. When I go in a field and it's all perfect and ready to go, it's magical. You know, you cannot beat the feeling of standing in a field of perfect vegetables, looking around you, harvest are revving up in the background, ready to go. It never loses its magic, and that's why we get up in the morning.
Andrew was certainly up early this morning. It's the very first day of his crucial potato harvest. By the end of today, we'll have an idea how the crop for 2013 is likely to do.
So this must be a super busy time for you, a passionate potato man. So thank you, first of all, for having us here at that time.
Pleasure.
And then secondly, we can see the harvester hard at work there. How many can that harvest?
That can harvest about 40 tonnes an hour.
How many is 40 tonnes? How many potatoes 40 tonnes?
That's 40 boxes the size of your car.
An hour?
An hour.
That's extraordinary.
But what I'm noticing, look, have a feel of that. Isn't that lovely? From a gardening point of view, that is amazing soil. And Lincolnshire soil is famed for its potato growing potential.
Yeah, this is fantastic dirt. I mean, every gardener in the world would die for this stuff.
Mm.
This is a really soft, silty soil. We're quite close to the coast. We're actually below sea level where we stood now, and this is reclaimed land. But this land is, this soil is so smooth. You feel it through
it's
your fingers.
It's really soft and light.
And that gives us the perfect shaped potato, but also a really lovely smooth skin. And it's got such a lot of small particles in it, it holds the water and the moisture. So it helps us grow a really good crop without too much rainfall.
And this is reclaimed land, you say, from the sea, is it?
Yeah. The further inland, the older it was reclaimed. The Romans started reclaiming the land, and the last bit right near the coast was actually reclaimed in 1976.
Romans must have loved chips.
They've stopped reclaiming land now. They're now actually reflooding some of the land for wildlife.
What other varieties do you grow here?
Well, so we've got Corolla that we're harvesting here at the moment. It, also in this field, we've got Belle de Fontenay.
Oh, I love them. The rat as well. You and I have just become good friends. anything else?
In this field, no, but around the rest of the farm, we've got Maris Piper, King Edward, Charlotte, all the standard ones.
The classics.
Yeah.
I'm a big fan of the salad potato, and you've obviously got some splendid ones here, but, of course, you can't do anything without the weather, can you?
No, the weather is absolutely critical. It was a total nightmare last year.
Yeah, seriously.
And this spring was very cold and late. In fact, we are running late now. We stood in this field here, which is our first field to lift, but this really ought to have been ready 2 or 3 weeks ago, and we really ought to be cracking on with the main crop now, and they're not ready yet. They're green over there, you can see them.
You see, Mother Nature can be a good friend to the farmer. It can also be an enemy. Let's remind ourselves just how atrocious the wet weather was in 2012.
The summer of 2012 was the wettest for 100 years and the darkest for a quarter of a century. £600 million worth of crops were lost.
Their worst harvest for decades, we're told this morning.
We're being warned to expect further increases in the price of food.
Veg prices rose by up to a half as farmers struggled to get poor quality crops from sodden ground. Our farmer, Andrew, had never seen his potato fields so wet. By mid-November 2012, Andrew was at his wit's end with the weather.
We're here in Home Fen. We're just below sea level here, and we're coming into a field of King Edwards on this lovely black soil. It started raining in April, and it's never really stopped since. Oh, dear. It's affected the growth of the crop. It's a very small crop, and there's bits of this field that we're not going to harvest. You can see how small these potatoes are. They're so small because they haven't had enough sunlight. Soil is such an important factor for us, having a healthy soil with good nutritional balance, and it all just goes down the drain when you get this, and we have to start again. We'll have to start rebuilding this soil structure from scratch. You know, my father's 74, it's the wettest year he can remember in farming. It's one I'd love to forget, but I'm sure we never will.
Crikey, mate, how bad was that?
Last year was awful. It was demoralising, it never stopped raining, everything was covered in mud, it was very unpleasant to work in, very bad for the morale of the blokes. I mean, just working in that mud, it was like the Battle of the Somme every day. It was pretty bad. But most importantly, we had a crop that was about 30% down in yield. So we really need a good year this year to make up for last year.
Can I just say, I mean, I'm no expert, and you need a good year. This doesn't look like the healthiest of fields. It looks half dead.
No, well, I thought you knew all about farming. When the crop is ready, we burn the tops off, we kill the tops off, and that enables the skin to set and get tough so that when we handle it, we can store it, as opposed to your new potato, where you've got your fluffy skin, which you know all about.
Well, I knew the difference between new and salad, but I never knew that's what made
it. Yeah, that bit over there is just about ready for burning off, and you can see the tops are dying back naturally, but we'll come in and finish them off.
Cheers, mate. Thank you very much. I've learned something there. You know, generations of clever farmers have learnt how to look after the potato, but what made us fall in love with this little tuber?
Farmers know the potato as a surprisingly complex character. Scarred skin and black eyes suggest a bit of a bruiser. But the potato is a surprisingly fragile soul who needs careful tending. People and potatoes have looked after each other since the Inca first cultivated the crop for food some 6,000 years ago. Grown on the terraces of the palace at Machu Picchu and across Peru, spuds thrived in the wet, cool mountain climate. So they felt at home when they arrived in Britain 400 years ago. Now, it's not only our favourite veg, it's by far the most grown vegetable crop on Earth. Our ancestors loved what was then an exotic new wonder, because eaten with the skin, the spud contains nearly all the minerals and vitamins we need for life. But these days, the likes of pasta and rice compete with the old staple crops.
You may find this hard to believe, but vegetable consumption in the UK is actually falling. To keep his fields busy, our farmer Andrew can't just rely on growing the old favourites. He needs to entice us into eating more veg by developing exciting new varieties. This very special trial patch is his secret weapon. Here, Andrew's planted exotic new veg he's discovered on his world travels. And who knows, maybe in this field in Lincolnshire is hidden the next top veg, something none of us has ever seen before. What about that, Andrew? What do you got? Look at that.
Let's hope so.
Look at that. An orange cauliflower. Innovation?
Yep.
Now, I know you like to mess around with veg. I know you do. But how important is innovation to your business or any veg business?
It's extremely important, especially to our business. We have to keep reinventing ourselves, keep creating premium lines.
Why? Tell me. Is it because you get more money for something new or...?
Yeah, well, there's the old saying that today's premium is tomorrow's standard, and you try and find me an example of that isn't true.
Absolutely, because I've heard you were trendy once. Now look at you.
Yeah, same with you. I heard that about you.
Big crate, loads of lovely veg. I've got a game for you here, right?
Yep.
I'm a greengrocer, all right? You're the farmer. Try to convince me to buy some of these things.
Some of the things we do are just for colour. So, you know, the orange cauliflower, the purple cauliflower, they're just for colour. Some of the things we've got here, I've selected out for flavour. And I went to Japan last year and I bought about one or two really special things. Let's have a look at this one.
That looks to me very much like a standard old Chinese leaf.
Yeah, but it ain't. This is a cross between a cabbage and a lettuce. You can shave it and use it in a salad, like an iceberg. You have a taste of that.
Will it braise as well, like a cabbage?
Yeah, you can stir fry it or braise it. Now, you thought it was a Chinese leaf cabbage. Chinese leaf has a hairy petiole, leaf stem.
And that is as smooth as you like. Yep. That is juicy, and it's also slightly sweet.
And you can eat it raw. Chinese leaf, you can't eat raw. Try that.
So that can be a lettuce or a cabbage. Mm.
So for the summer periods, when vegetable consumption's down, and therefore we're quiet as a business, this has a really good potential for us to help fill our summer season.
Do you know what? I thought I'd seen it all. I really do. That is a beautiful thing. And it's got a slight, like, hint of allium, like, slight hint of onion at the end.
A little bit of peppery aftertaste.
Mate, that is good. What else you got?
This one.
That's a kohlrabi.
That ain't just any old kohlrabi. This is a melon kohlrabi.
You're enjoying this, mate, aren't you?
Yep. You have a taste of this.
Oh, my word. That is a little bit like an apple. Maybe a little bit like a melon. And again, really fresh and just... I can't believe you can take a kohlrabi like that and eat this raw.
Yeah, it's amazing. So
that is amazing.
Yeah, looks like a kohlrabi. But, I mean, all the guys in the factory thought it was a melon when we blind tasted it.
Is that right? Mm. Mate, are these in the shops yet?
No, this is all brand new stuff and we haven't got enough of them to actually start selling yet. So what we do through the trials process, we have the discovery phase, which is what we're looking at now, and then we start to scale things up. So maybe next year, 4 or 5 acres, give it a try through the shops. If it sells well, we scale it up until we've got a full-scale product on our hands.
You know what I do. You know I work with food, right? I
mean, I heard a rumour.
That is amazing.
Yeah, it's incredible.
I mean, that was good. That is incredible.
Well, when we're going around the world, we try hundreds of things in this field, and every year we get 3 or 4 things that I get excited about.
I'm excited.
And that's the way it goes. It's this big filter process until we find a winner.
I thought there was nothing new in fruit and veg, honestly. I am really, really impressed.
This sweet shop of exotic veg isn't just exciting, it's puzzling. How do you come up with whole new crop varieties? For such big questions, we've enlisted food fanatic Stefan Gates. Of the world's 16,000 different plant groups, or genera, our food comes from just 12. From these, humans have created a dazzling array of crop varieties, each with a different taste and appearance. Natural variation in plants is down to chance. Everything about them is constantly being refined by evolution.
Sometimes a mutation happens by chance that means a plant is more likely to survive. So if you've got a gene that makes you slightly taller than your neighbours, you'll get more sunlight, and so you're more likely to thrive.
Natural selection is a lengthy process, but through artificial selection, farmers can speed things up by selecting the characteristics we like best.
Mange 2 peas are usually green. The plant's genes act like an internal instruction manual, telling it to produce a green pod. But what if there's a chance mutant, a random plant with purple pods, and it's the purple colour that I want to keep?
By cross-pollinating the flowers of the purple pea plants with those of other plants, it's possible to help them reproduce. So we can artificially spread the genes of the purple pods around. And this increases the chances of purple offspring.
It's a painstakingly slow process because you have to do this over and over again over generations of peas. But eventually, most of my crop should be purple.
In this trial field, our farmer Andrew has planted his pick of the best new varieties, bred all over the world. To pay for these new veg developments, he's desperate that 2013 is a good year for one of his biggest sellers, the potato.
Only now, with the potato harvest beginning, will Andrew discover how many precious spuds have survived the chilly spring and hot, dry summer. And Andrew's also worried about his broccoli, along with carrots, onions, and many others. All crops with their own particular needs that must be met through the year.
Seeing the world from their crop's point of view is absolutely vital for a farmer's success. They all have different requirements, the crops. For example, the carrots like a light, sandy type of soil if they're going to do well. Broccoli likes an alkali soil. And potatoes, well, they need lots of sunshine and lots of rain if they're going to thrive. Now, most of these vegetables are planted out as tiny, tiny seeds, but not the potato. The potato comes from another potato, a seed potato. And when I'm gardening, it always amazes me how you can plant these out and then at harvest time, they've multiplied into so, so many more. And of course, it's harvest time now, a critical time for farmer Andrew as he finds out just how many potatoes his seed potatoes have multiplied into. It was back in April that we joined him as he was planting out his seed potatoes and keeping his fingers firmly crossed.
So we're planting these lovely Mozart potatoes. This is a time of optimism when we're planting the new crops. And if you can't be optimistic at this time of year as a farmer, you may as well pack up. You can just see the little shoot on the end where it's just starting to grow. From this one potato, we'll probably get about another 20 potatoes.
To prevent disease building up in his plants, Andrew doesn't use any of last year's crop as seed potatoes. Each spring, he plants fresh seed potatoes bought from specialist breeders.
We've got a big machine. It's got a tank on the back. We're going to put these in the ground 6 inches deep and a foot apart, and we should have about 20 tonnes an acre come September. Cup comes through, picks up the potato, makes a little hole, plants it, and buries it again. Beautiful day, but only 3 weeks ago there was snow on the ground here. The soil at 8 to 9 inches deep is still very cold, and that's going to get us off to a bit of a slow start. We've got these potatoes on the ridges. We try and grow them as close as we can from north to south, because the sun rises in the east, goes through the south, sets in the west, and this lovely broad edge that we've got to the ridge really absorbs the sun. We'll stick the finger in there now. I can even feel the warmth of that scallop today compared with the cold soil we're cultivating over there. We've cultivated the soil, we've got all the clods out, and then we've used all the best bits to actually grow the potato in, which is going to give us a lovely smooth skin and a nice shape on the potato. And when we come to harvest in September, it'll be nice and easy to separate the potatoes from the soil. We're going to invest over £100,000 growing the crop in this field, plus there's £1 million worth of kit tied up in harvesting and planting equipment and irrigation. And if everything goes well and we grow a good crop, we'll make about 0.2 of a pence per potato. Potatoes, you only get one shot a year. It's really crucial to get it right.
Back then, in April, Andrew didn't know a heat wave would hit in July, just when his potatoes wanted water. Now, Andrew is harvesting those spuds. Soon we'll discover how that heat affected the crop. Andrew's profit margin is just 0.2 pence per potato. So he's got to fill massive crate after massive crate. This many, and at least the same again, just from this one farm.
Fire up.
Time to meet his harvest machine.
Thanks for stopping it, because this is a massive big beast. I want to have a look at this in a bit, but I've got to ask you, at 0.2 pence profit on a potato, you've got to do five to make a penny.
Yep, that's after I've grown a good crop.
Only if you get a good crop. Yep. So by my calculations, if you want to make £2,000 profit, you've got to sell, what, 1 million potatoes?
Not very good at maths, but sounds about right.
That's and these things can't come cheap.
Now you're looking at about, with the tractor, about £200,000 worth of investment with this machine.
You see, I just don't see the economics, Andrew. I just don't get it.
I know, I sometimes wonder.
Every single potato is important. But if that's so, and I do believe it, this doesn't look like the most gentler things to take care of them, to be honest.
No, well, it's very simple but very clever design. We've basically got the big digging spade on the front. We call it a share. That lifts the whole bed of soil and potatoes onto the web.
It goes under them?
The web is like a giant sieve.
Oh, I got you.
And it actually sieves the potatoes from the soil. The soil falls through. The potatoes carry on through the machine. And then the potatoes go up into the elevator and up to the yard. We're just at the start of our potato harvest now, and we've got 7 or 8 real busy weeks coming up now, probably the busiest weeks of the year.
See, what I'm thinking is that we don't just eat fruit and veg in the spring and summer, we actually want it 365 days a year. So how clever have the farmers got to be to get produce up fresh in the cold months, even if the ground's frozen?
Mid-January doesn't look like harvest season, but it is. It seems the animals have winter's playground all to themselves. Apart from one solitary figure, farmer Ian Hall.
Shall I have a look here?
Carrots, fresh from the ground in the middle of winter. It's no surprise to Ian. He planted these carrots last spring, and all summer they've grown big and strong. By October, they were ready, but not for harvest. It was time to put them to bed. Every autumn, farmers like Ian store more than 10,000 acres of carrots in fields right across the UK.
We're covering the crop with a sheet of black plastic, and what that does is that keeps the light out so that these tops and these carrots don't start to regrow. So we protect the bed with that, and then we put a layer of straw on it, which protects the carrots from the cold, keeps them lovely and warm, a bit like your quilt at home.
Throughout the long winter months, the earth acts as Mother Nature's larder, keeping Ian's carrots fresh and ready for harvest at any time. On this freezing January day, Ian's got to fill 27 tractor and trailer loads. So it's time to wake this field of carrots up. Time to bring in the monster carrot harvester.
Interestingly, the worse the weather, the more challenging environment we have to work in, the more the orders go up. Carrot sales will always be higher when it's cold. People go back to stews and traditional Sunday roast.
Around a third of our carrots are put to sleep under straw for harvest in winter. Unlike most other veg, they're grown in light, sandy soil, which breaks apart when chilly. It wouldn't work for potatoes grown in heavy soil. They have to be harvested before winter and kept in expensive cold storage. For these carrots, Mother Nature does the chilling. While we're all snowed in at home, the British harvest must continue, because the demand for carrots never stops.
Well, carrots are big business, worth over £300 million a year. Do you know, on a really good harvest, we dig up about 100 carrots for every single person in this country. So by now, you should have eaten about 70 or 80 of them, have you? But that's carrots. Right now, we're in the middle of a broccoli field, another one of Andrew's big passions, and we are smack bang in the middle of the harvest. And I've got to ask you, there's no ignoring it, what is that enormous tent on wheels?
Well, that's my favourite toy. That I went to California, got this idea, and what that does, it's a factory in the field.
Well, there's a gang of guys working inside that thing as well.
Wrapping and labelling.
Well, that is state-of-the-art, isn't it?
Yep.
And right at the cutting edge of that is Philippa, right now.
Now, this is actually quite a tricky one to harvest. What I have to do is assess how heavy that broccoli is, then cut the same length as the width of the head of broccoli in one swift movement, remove the leaves and put it in the right container for the right supermarket, because different containers, colours, want different weights in them. So there's a lot to think about. And also, you have to move fairly swiftly, otherwise you're going to get run over at the same time. It's worth it, though. Broccoli is a superfood. Let's find out more about it.
Rich in vitamins D and C, bursting with antioxidants, broccoli is a cousin of the cabbage and the cauliflower. You can trace its family tree back thousands of years to Italy. Calabrese, as they say, must be planted in warm soil. What we eat is actually an immature flower head. Leave it a moment too long and it goes over into bloom. It's a tricky blighter, broccoli. Timing is all important.
At the end of March, Andrew's broccoli timings were in crisis due to the weather. It was exceptionally cold, and Andrew's fields weren't drying out enough to use the broccoli planting machine. So a staggering 20 million young broccoli and cauliflower plants were stuck in the greenhouses because they couldn't be put in the ground. When the fields were ready, they all had to go in at once. But getting the broccoli plants in was only the beginning. The long, cold spring dragged on and on.
Andrew, it is a stunning crop now. How did you fare through that really difficult spring then?
Well, it was very cold, the plants were late. The four planters that we put in April, it was so cold they didn't grow at all. And then when it did warm up, they all grew together and we had a glut of broccoli at the end of June.
Which is great, isn't it?
No, because we overloaded the marketplace, because we should be planting every day and we should be harvesting every day. So if we get four lots come together, we just have too much. The hardest thing about broccoli is matching supply and demand. When the sun comes out and it gets warm, it grows like crazy and nobody wants to eat vegetables.
So what happened?
We sold some off into freezing, some off to export, and some of it we had to plough in.
You didn't?
Yep.
So you were harvesting at four lots all at once as well?
Yep.
So that must have been difficult.
Yeah, well, we went 24 hours a day.
Through the
seven
night?
Days a week, yeah.
You can't do that through the night.
It's got fantastic floodlights on it and we double shifted it.
And then you had to plough what perfectly good broccoli back into the ground?
Perfectly good broccoli, yeah. Yeah, and the only benefit we get from it is a bit of fertiliser for the next crop.
How did that make you feel?
Sick as a parrot.
Must have been heartbreaking, wasn't it?
It is, but it's just one of those things that goes with growing broccoli.
Yeah.
It's the biggest challenge in broccoli is getting supply and demand to match up all the year round. If we had 12 months weather forecast and it was absolutely spot on, we wouldn't have a problem.
Wouldn't we all love that, though? Thanks, Andrew. But as I said, you've got a cracking crop now. It's brilliant.
Thank you.
And Gregg, as we speak, is packing it.
Well, I'm on an amazing moving factory and I'm here with Boxer, who's in charge of this great big rig, right?
Yes.
And how long have you had this moving warehouse?
Well, we have that third here now.
3 years?
Yes.
And let me understand what's happening. We've got a team of cutters at the front.
Yes.
Then it's coming in, taken off of these, and every now and again one is weighed to check. Then I suppose you've got to get them cellophane wrapped.
Yeah, it's lady there, which is put label on the head, and she is last person which is checking.
So for all the picking and weighing, we then wrap it with cellophane, put a sticker on it. But how long does it take each spear of broccoli to go through the cutters, through selection, weighing, machinery, and packing?
About 1 minute.
1 minute.
Yeah.
And you have to get that broccoli just before it flowers. However, with Andrew's potato crop, flowering is vitally important.
It was in July that farmer Andrew was checking his spud crop at the crucial flowering time.
We're here in this beautiful field of Maris Piper. It's just coming into flower. They're very pretty. They're an indicator as to what's going on under the ground. So we start off with the mother tuber. This is the seed potato that we plant in the spring. And the stems then produce the little potatoes, as you can see these little tiny potatoes on here. And these are the little baby potatoes that swell to turn into these, and then eventually into the baking potatoes that you see in the shops. What the plant needs now to get these potatoes to their full size is plenty of water and plenty of sunshine.
Out of sight, underground, Andrew hoped sunshine and water were creating a miracle of nature. Potatoes forming in the soil. To unearth the magic, here's Stefan Gates.
How and why does sunshine and water get converted into a potato?
Above ground, photosynthesis creates the sugars the plant needs to grow.
Any extra sugars that the plant doesn't need to use immediately are instead used as building blocks to make larger starch molecules.
The starch is stored in the potato tuber we eat. Starch doesn't dissolve in water, so it's a safe way to store energy in the wet earth.
Every single potato is like a power cell for the plant, packed to bursting with starch molecules. And that means it's full of energy.
The potato uses its stored energy to grow a new plant. We use that starch for food.
I know when you taste a potato, you don't think of the energy, but just have a little look. I'm going to put a couple of teaspoons of starch into this bit of piping and then blow it across a naked flame. See what happens. And what you saw there was the energy being released in just about 30 or 40 calories of starch.
The average spud contains around 150 calories. About 10 potatoes would provide all your daily needs. Now, this isn't recommended, but skin-on potatoes are so rich in nutrients that supplemented with a bit of butter for fat, you could pretty much live just eating potatoes.
Back in early July, Farmer Andrew knew exactly what he wanted for his spuds to fill out.
Sunshine's a key thing. We can put as much water on as we want, but we can't make the sunshine.
And boy, oh boy, did the sun shine in July. The longest heat wave this century, and it was heaven sent for potato farmers like Andrew. Long dry conditions aren't a crisis for commercial growers. They invest in irrigation systems to soak their spuds. Farmers know that every year their plants will require lots of water once they've flowered to build up the potatoes. But even with the exceptional summer sun in July and August, growers couldn't know for sure what was happening out of sight in the soil. Now we're in the potato harvest. Only at the end of today will Andrew really know the quality and quantity.
So there seems to be plenty of potatoes here, mate.
Yeah.
How many more fields you got to go?
We only just started. That's the first field. We've got about another 20 or 30 fields to go yet.
Where do they go from here?
From here, they go to the packhouse for washing and pre-packing ready for the supermarkets.
Right, OK, fair enough. It's not that easy, is it? You don't just plant the seed and watch them grow, do you? What are some of your biggest issues?
I wish it was that easy. But no, there's loads of challenges, but the biggest one's got to be potato blight.
What is that?
It's a fungal disease that kills the foliage and then rots the potato.
And will it kill it all stone dead?
Completely. If you get it in your crop, it's a total disaster, and it's very contagious. It spreads very quickly across the country.
What can you do?
Well, we have to spray. So, you know, this year it's been nice and dry, so we get away with once a fortnight. Last year, a lot of blight pressure. We had to spray every week. We hate spraying because it costs us a lot of money. It costs a small fortune.
Yeah, you don't really want to if you don't have to.
No, no.
So, listen, tell me, honestly, is this a question of if you don't spray, you just lose the lot and that's it?
Yeah, if you've got potato blight in your crop, it's a write-off.
Well, potato blight is just one of the natural enemies that farmers have to contend with. But can you imagine if you could grow in an environment that you could completely control? Well, back in January, Philippa visited a farm in Kent where they are attempting just that.
It is a freezing morning, around -1 now, with highs of just 3 degrees today. So if you're out and about, make sure you wrap up warm. We're going to be getting an update on the outlook.
In the middle of winter and in the middle of the night, here in Kent, they harvest tomatoes.
An army of pickers marches to work. And today, I'm joining them.
Morning. Morning, Philippa. How are you?
Freezing.
Yeah, you can take off your winter stuff now.
Yeah?
Leaving winter outside, suddenly I feel like I'm walking into summer.
It goes on forever. It's amazing!
It is, isn't it?
What an enormous place! Is this what happens to me? Wait, is this what happens to me if I stay in this greenhouse? I turn into the size of you. Have you spent too long in the greenhouse?
I have.
Dutch tomato guru Gert van Stralen is a big man with an even bigger office. Gert's hoping his greenhouse will give him a bigger bite out of the UK tomato business, worth over £600 million and growing. UK farmers only meet about one-fifth of our demand, so there's plenty of room for them to expand their market share.
So if I look down there, I can hardly see the end. If I look down there, I can hardly see the end. How big is it?
It's about 25 acres or 10 football pitches.
This one greenhouse, this one building is 25 acres?
It is, yeah.
So how many tomato plants does that translate to?
We have about 400,000 plants in the greenhouse, and we'll be producing about 50,000 kilos of tomatoes this week. We are the only ones in the UK that do this, producing fruit through the winter.
Kilos of tomatoes in the middle of winter. How does Gert do it? Like his plants, I'm heading up towards the rising sun to find out.
This is an altogether very different view. Goes on for miles.
This is where it happens.
We've got blue sky today, and it's easy to forget that it's absolutely freezing.
It is.
And obviously, we were in here since it was dark. So how are you managing to grow tomatoes in the middle of the UK, in the middle of winter?
The secret is this Formula One greenhouse. We have all the ingredients that you need for perfect plant growing.
During the winter months, daylight just isn't enough. So these huge lights illuminate and heat the greenhouse 16 hours a day. Buying electricity off the grid would be expensive. So this greenhouse has its own gas-fired power station. The waste heat is fed back into the glasshouse. They also pipe waste carbon dioxide from the power plant into the tomato plants. The extra CO2 increases photosynthesis, so they grow quicker.
These plants are so happy.
Yes, they are. You can absolutely see. They're much bigger than any tomato plant I've ever grown.
That's because the conditions are perfect for growing. The plants grow about a foot per week.
A foot a week?
A foot a week, yeah.
That's extraordinary.
We actually have more light available to the plants than a Spanish or Italian producer would have.
Outside?
Outside, correct.
So in here, it's better than the Mediterranean?
It is.
Gert is able to control every aspect of the growing environment. He's regulating the temperature and making sure his tomato plants have all the food and water they need. It's this high-tech greenhouse that allows Gert to produce his tomatoes year-round. Tomatoes picked today should taste just as good as those harvested in the summer. But I still haven't tasted one yet.
You can lay out all the tomatoes you want, but my deep belief is that I will never find another tomato to match the first one of the year that I pick off the plant in my own greenhouse.
Philippa, you couldn't be further from the truth.
There's one particular variety Gert thinks will win me over.
This is called Piccolo.
Mm-hmm. That's the perfect tomato. Really sweet, with just enough crunch.
So is it better than
fresh.
Yours?
Not nearly as good as mine, but you're, you know, 9 out of 10. You're nearly there. Yeah,
thank you.
Some question the energy cost of growing tomatoes in Britain in winter. Gert would argue it's no worse than shipping them in from Spain or Holland, where they're grown in similar greenhouses. In the end, it's our insatiable appetite for tomatoes that fuels the development of facilities like this and keeps the tomato harvest going year-round.
Tomatoes aren't the only produce we're very particular about. Growers know they must deliver appealing-looking veg to tempt us to take their harvest home. Months of worry and hard work nurturing these potatoes may yet come to nothing. They may make it out of the ground, but are they good enough to go to the shops?
And here are the first of the salad potato harvest. Yep. They're bought here after you've harvested them to be sorted. But actually, this is also crucial quality control for you, isn't it?
Yeah, this is obviously on the first day of harvest at the moment, and we have to treat these potatoes as delicately as possible without breaking them.
That is so surprising to me, you know, the rough, tough spud. And actually, you've got to be so gentle with them.
It's not rough and tough at all. It bruises very easily.
So how do you sort that out through the system?
By very well-designed machinery with maximum drops of 3 or 4 inches, and then also by good machinery settings according to the different conditions.
Quality control is obviously clearly important to you before any potato even leaves here, isn't it?
That's right, yeah. We've got a simulator, which I'll show you down here.
Yeah.
This very simple little device delivers enough force to simulate a 5-inch drop under concrete.
Okay.
This potato will then go in what we call a hot box, which is a sort of warm, like an airing cupboard with high humidity, for 24 hours. And then the next day, we get the potatoes out of the hot box and we peel them.
Yeah.
And we're looking for the bruising. And the most susceptible places are on the ends of the potatoes. And these are clean, there's no bruising in these.
So it really is quite a process after... I mean, I just thought you'd just have to dig them up and send them off.
If only life was that easy.
Yeah, but you're actually really checking out the bruising potential and the ones that are bruised.
That's right,
And what happens to the ones that are bruised?
Well, if we get a sample with too many bruising, we can't use it for our premium outlets, so it'd end up going for processing or for animal feed.
So these potatoes going in there now, what happens to them?
We're going to size them, so we're going to split them into small and large. And then they're going to go away to the pack house for washing and pre-packing.
Harvest 2013 is heading our way. Over the next year, on average, each one of us will eat the equivalent of 380 medium-sized potatoes. Everything about spuds comes in big numbers, except the profit per bag. To make money, most vegetable farmers have to scale up their production. But I've met one grower whose big idea is a small-scale harvest. Tiny, in fact. To search out this micro-business, I headed north, to Scotland. St Andrews is famous as the home of golf. But it's also home to a small farm that's supplying some very big customers, with some rather extraordinary veg.
Now, are they baby vegetables, or have I grown an enormous head? They're cute, aren't they? And I'd really like to find out more about them.
Henry Aykroyd used to grow normal-sized veg for some of our biggest supermarkets, but he struggled to make it pay, so he downsized his product. And now his customer base is more Michelin-starred, people like Gordon Ramsay and Heston Blumenthal.
Oh, is it harvest time, Henry?
That's right, Gregg.
Can I lend a hand?
Of course you can.
I'll be quite gentle with it. Beautiful little turnips. How do you get them to only grow to that size?
Well, it's all about plant density, really, Gregg. These are grown at nearly 800 to the square metre. In these perfect conditions in here, they just take 4 or 5 weeks to grow.
So if they were more spaced out, they'd get bigger? That's
More time and more space, they'd get much bigger.
And how much is the average order?
We're charging 25 pence a unit for these.
Some people might think that's ridiculously expensive, but I don't. I can see that. Mm. I mean, in a smart restaurant, you probably only get 3 of those on a plate anyway.
Mm.
So that's 75 pence. Henry has grown some fantastic veg, and I suppose shrinking his business literally has increased the profit. I mean, he used to get 25 pence for half a kilo of veg. Now he gets 25 pence for every single little turnip.
But it isn't all about the size. Henry's also experimenting with some revolutionary growing techniques.
It's like a disco for little plants.
Henry is collaborating with Professor John Allen. In the 1960s, John developed the world's first practical LED lights. Now John is working with the horticulture industry to research how coloured LEDs may increase plant growth.
Right. Are you going to explain or try to explain some of the science behind this to me?
Here I've got some radishes. They've been growing for 3 weeks from seed, and these are growing under 100% red light. And you can see the top growth is quite long. And these have been grown under 100% blue, and you see they're very much shorter.
No chemicals?
No chemicals, just light.
No growing additives?
No growing additives.
That's just crazy.
The difference between those three is entirely the colour of the light.
John's red light has increased photosynthesis in his plant, making it grow bigger. But John's also discovered that combining red light with blue light increases root growth, and that could make better veg.
So if the light can affect the shape and colour of the plant, I'm almost scared to ask this, could it also affect the flavour?
Yes. Well, you can try it. Have a bit of that and have a bit of that. And see if they're different.
Well, that one's quite strong and peppery. That one's mild.
Yes.
They taste completely different.
Yes. But it's exciting.
It's very, very exciting. Anything else?
The nutritional quality of the plant can be changed by the colour of the light.
A red or blue light or a combination can actually make our foods better for us.
That's right.
This is...
And that's important.
That's seriously important.
Mm. Science is fun.
You are going to be really famous. You won't any longer have to do Father Christmas in the department store.
Well, that brings in useful pocket money.
John isn't alone in researching the effect of light on plant growth and taste. The results may have a really big impact on our future harvest. At the moment, Henry's feeding high-end diners, but John hopes that one day, what they learn with these tiny crops will help feed the world with higher quality vegetables.
Now, look at that. Who'd have ever have believed it, that you could actually change the flavour of a vegetable by shining a different colour light on it? Henry and John may appear to be a bit eccentric, but I honestly think they've stumbled on something here. I know it's early days, but I think this might be the future. A different colour light can make a vegetable taste better and make it more nutritious. That is amazing.
But right now, what concerns us more is Andrew's crop. Now, Andrew, unlike other vegetables, your potatoes have been grown under the ground. So they're being lifted for the first time today, and now we'll get a real idea about the quality and the quantity.
Yeah, that's right. This is the day of judgment, the moment of truth. It doesn't matter how many times you sample, you never know what you've got till you put the harvester in the field.
Well, we've got a load coming in now. Is that the first field?
It's the last load of the first field.
Right. So have you got an idea about yields?
Yeah, I'm quite happy with the yield in here. It's a lot better than last year. Not quite up to target, but I'm a lot happier than I was this time last year.
So indications are it's going the right way again?
It's going the right way, yeah.
OK, yep. Right, a cook like me, right, old greengrocer, the quality. What's it looking like?
Well, I'm very happy with the quality of this particular crop. It's very clean, it's got just the right size. This is a salad potato crop, so a lovely waxy flesh potato.
Andrew, you look pretty satisfied to me.
Yeah, I'm happy, yeah.
Where you been, on the tractor?
On the tractor, yeah. You know me and farm machinery, yeah. Can't help it.
Big boys' toys, eh?
Yeah, love it. What I want to know, though, is how is the broccoli harvest going now?
Broccoli harvest is going quite well now after the glut in June, and we're going to be going flat out till the middle of November.
Middle of November, that's amazing.
So, potatoes are up, that's good. Broccoli looks good. Any other notable successes?
Carrots were late start, but we're going OK now. Onions I don't think is ever going to quite make the target.
Mixed reports, but all in all...
Yeah, I'm a lot happier than last year.
Good to know.
So the question is, are we going to import into the UK potatoes and other vegetables this year, or will we be self-sufficient? Time to find out how Harvest 2013 has affected the rest of the country.
Let's look at the national picture, starting with potatoes. In a year, on average, we grow 5.7 million tonnes. But in 2012, wet weather hit potatoes hard. The crop was down nearly a quarter. Harvest 2013 will be better. We predict spuds up 20% on last year. The glorious summer broke the British record for salad sales. Congratulations to our farmers who grew around 15% more salad leaf than last year. But it's not all good news. Some veg struggled to grow in the cold spring, and farmers are still counting the cost. Carrots are currently down about 8%, but they should catch up. What about onions? On average, we grow 400,000 tons of onions a year. In 2012, onion farmers failed to reach that target. Harvest 2013 is likely to be even worse. Onions didn't get the warm spring needed for their bulbs to fill out. But good news for Brussels sprout lovers. In 2012, sprouts fell well short. But this year, early reports suggest a green Christmas. Sprouts may be up by a third. So on the whole, our vegetable farmers are happy in the sun of 2013.
So, Andrew, a brief moment to just sit with us and think about how this year's gone, because we've been following you through this whole year, which has been such a privilege. And thank you for having us. And it's been amazing to see just what you go through and what you're faced with in the course of a year.
Yeah, well, it all starts again tomorrow for us. We're already planning and planting next year's crops at Christmas. King Edward potatoes, parsnips and Brussels sprouts, they all go mad at Christmas.
So you got another harvest before the end of the year?
We have a huge week. The biggest week of our year is Christmas week.
Is it? And you've still got a smile on your face?
Yeah, I know. I don't know why.
Can we get stuck into some of these? Chips here, roasties, I mean... Actually, when you look at this, you're actually providing the nation's favourite foods, aren't you?
That's the plan.
That is what you're doing. Look at that. I mean, I don't know anyone in these beautiful windswept islands that does enjoy it.
Yeah, well, we've got Maris Papa for the chips, King Edward for the roasties, and Carole for the salads.
See, I haven't eaten one of these, can I?
Yeah, help yourself.
Are you a skin-on man, are you?
I'm definitely a skin-on man for salads, yeah.
And these are the ones that we were digging up today?
Yeah, this is the field we just finished.
Oh.
And will you tell me what you think of them?
Well, that is soft and,
oh,
it's,
lovely flavour.
And it's earthy. Mm. It's really earthy. You don't know a dairy farmer who's got a kilo of butter, do you?
Not round here.
we could be set, couldn't we?
But we have got some nice beer. Yeah.
Do you know what? I tell you what's really impressed me. Two things. One is the scale of the operation to farm potatoes. But the other one is the passion for the subject. How did it get under your skin like that?
I just love farming. Yeah, growing crops, growing great crops on great farms is just, it's so satisfying.
And this year particularly must have been a bit more satisfying.
Last year was a disaster. I do want to forget about it. It's a year I'll probably never forget, but I wish I could. But this year, it's been quite good fun.
Good. Despite having us around.
Despite having you lot around. We've had quite a laugh, really.
We've learned so much as well, so thank you very much. And if you want to pick up some tips and some recipes written by the great Gregg Wallace, bbc.co.uk/harvest, and you can download this leaflet.
They're not just some recipes, can I say? They are fantastic recipes, easy to do and delicious. And you can also find out online about events surrounding the harvest near you, free ones as well. I'd just like to raise a glass because, you know, where would we be in Britain, in the UK, without the potato?
Cheers to the potato.
Well, cheers to you, Andrew.
King Edward.
Yeah.
Next time, as the harvest continues, we unleash the combines.
We discover what it takes to bring in our daily bread.
Join us for Harvest 2013 tomorrow at 8 o'clock.